Now, with no further ado, our keynote speaker, Sister Soldier.
Thank you very much. I would like to start by acknowledging all of the families that are gathered here today and thanking Reverend Daughtry and Mrs. Daughtry for the invitation, along with Deborah Dawkins, to present here at your church. I have a few things to say, and it's just my prayer that the things that I do have to say are taken in the right spirit and that they can be of some use to you. First, I would like to start by offering a short poem that appears as a dedication for a new novel that I've written called The Coldest Winter Ever. The reason why I entitled my new book The Coldest Winter Ever is because I believe that we are living in a very cold era. And this novel is a tale of love and loss and sex and violence and all of the things that go on, unfortunately, in the lives of too many of our young people. But I would like to start by reading the dedication of the novel to you. There is no such thing as love anymore, the kind that is so strong that you can feel it in your bones. You know, we used to feel that emotion when we looked into the faces of our mother, father, sisters, brothers, families, and friends. There's no such thing as love anymore, at least not the deep, satisfying kind that sits on your heart and influences every decision and action that you take throughout the day. There's no reason to celebrate anymore. Just empty actions and empty reactions, calculated gestures and financial arrangements. There's no such thing as love anymore. Why do our children suffer? Our children suffer because in order to bring about a change, there must be a radical sacrifice. In order to bring about a change, there must be a radical sacrifice. What do I mean by that? That it is not enough for us to get together and share our stories of pain. It is a good thing to do, but it is not enough. Because if we see that it has become a tradition for our children to be victims of violence, then we must then understand that something incredibly strong has to be done to change the momentum of the way that our country and the way that our world is moving. People are afraid of the criticism, because when criticism is raised, it means that there's a finger pointing at you. And nobody wants the finger pointing at them, because everybody wants to feel that everything they have done has been to the best of their ability. But too many of us are lazy, and too many of us are comfortable, and too many of us have accepted pain as the predominant feature in our lives. And what that means is that we have become comfortable with the ills that are happening to our children. We expect them to die young. We expect their friends to die young. We expect their cousins to die young. And we're upset about it, but not upset enough to bring about a radical change. What happened to our energy? The energy that we used in 1999 to argue over small things is not even the same energy that we use to confront people who are killing us and our children. There are people probably in this room who get more excited if somebody drank the last bit of Coca-Cola out of your refrigerator. Who took the Coca-Cola? Who moved my cigarette? Who told you you could have that? People who get more excited about little things like that and become silent and immobilized when a big grievance occurs, like the loss of your children and the loss of your relatives and the loss of your freedom and the loss of your justice. Could it be that we are all afraid that we can jump big and bad with one another? We can get real angry and hateful towards one another, but we can't muster up enough energy to change the conditions that create the tradition of death in our community. There will be no change without a movement. But what is a movement? People are too often believing that a movement is a style, or a fashion, or a hairstyle, that is clothing, or dashiki, or dreads, or incense lighting, that is chewing on a wooden stick, or having a poster of Malcolm X, or a red, black, and green button. But that's not a movement. A movement cannot exist where there is no love. The actual fact of the matter is that the reason why we are not connected to one another is because, for the most part, we do not love each other. Let's be real about that. Most of the time when you come into the room, you can't feel any love. And although people make gestures that sort of suggest that maybe they care about something a little bit, there is no real emotion involved. This is the reason why when we protest, the whole community is not present at the protest. Because they don't feel love, they don't love you, you don't love them, we don't love each other, and therefore we intellectually understand that there's a problem, but there's not enough love to generate enough energy to cause us to do anything about the problem. The world turns on a vibration. There has to be a vibration. If there's no vibration, there will be no movement. People don't want to be responsible for their actions anymore. Everyone says, I'm just doing this for the money. I may be naked, I may be stripping, but that's not me. When I go home, I'm really a nice girl. I may be shooting and killing in my video, but, you know, really I'm just a businessman. We got black adults that work in the prosecutor's office and see the parade of young black men and Latino men going to prison every day, and they say, well, this is where I work, but I'm really not a part of it all. Police officers who see other officers doing things that they know are completely inappropriate and don't take aggressive action to stop it before it occurs. Because in order to love, and in order to say that you believe in God, you have to do something. It's not enough to just say you believe. you are not going to be allowed to be good and evil. Because if you are good and evil, you will exist in a world that snatches your children from you, that snatches your loved ones from you, and you stand there in a state of confusion, not understanding what's going on. But what's going on is that with the belief in God and with the love of God would come some requirement. What is required of us? It is required of us that we each understand our role and our responsibility. Otherwise, as one of us lets go of our responsibilities, all of us suffer the consequence. This is why we must love everyone, because if one of us lets go of our responsibility, all of us suffer the consequence. We could all do a perfect job here in this room, but we have to walk outside of the church. We have to use those streets. We have to ride on those trains. We have to ride on those buses and get in those planes. We have to circulate and integrate and intermingle with other people. That means that you got to be concerned about them, because their pain and suffering, whatever it may be, will come to visit you. Whether you're paying attention or not, it'll knock on your door. And if you ignore it for too long, it'll rob you of what you covet, of what you feel most precious about. We need to return to our African tradition. I don't mean you need to return to your turban. When I say we need to return to our African traditions, I mean the things that we used to believe, because there were things that we believed and things that we practiced. Like we believe that I means we. That I am you and you are me, and we is us and us is them and them is they, and we are all in it together. We believe that. But we don't believe that today. Which is why we suffer today. Because we have bought into a system which tells us that I means I. It's all about me, 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 me. Right? Get money. Right? We believe that. And many of us have taught our children that. Without even saying that, we've taught our children that through our actions. And so our children have substituted the love for God with the love of money. And as they pursue the money, they lose their lives because they've lost the God within themselves and the force that they needed to stay alive. So in the African tradition, we are all connected. And once we lose that tradition, we become victims of a society that we love and aspire to be a part of that doesn't have the answers to our problems. How do we know that American society doesn't have the answers to our problems? Look at America's children. Look at the powerful people in charge. Ask yourself, do you want your personal lives to be like their personal lives? If you want your daughters and sons to be like their daughters and sons, and then challenge yourself to make a change in your own life. Too many of us are not raising our children to understand how to handle themselves as young boys and make a transition into becoming men. How to handle ourselves as young women and make a transition into becoming full-grown women. And if we don't begin to teach our children how to make that transition, they will be victims of the same things that we are victims of as adults. But everything is in a state of disorder. And in order to clean up, you gotta get started. Yeah. But when you look in the room, it's so dirty and so filthy, you feel overwhelmed, and then you don't even want to get started. What do we need to do? We need to straighten out first our individual selves so that when we come together as a collective, we can represent some type of power. What kind of sacrifices are you going to have to make as an individual? The first thing is to challenge your thinking so that you are understanding what's going on in your world. Turn off your television. Begin to read the newspapers. Listen to the news. Talk to your neighbors. Find out what's going on. Don't be afraid to speak up. Speak up about things that matter instead of all the things that don't matter. Uh-huh. Reading is critical. Because if you don't know what happened, then you won't understand what's happening. You will be confused. Which is why when parents lose somebody to the violence of the society and the news reporters come to them, they think that it's just happening to them and their family. And they're not understanding at that moment that this has become an American tradition for our children to die at premature ages. Get involved in movies. If the music is supposed to be the vibration, and the vibration that the music is giving you is not the vibration that you need to survive, then you've got to fight the music makers. You can't bury your sons to the tune of more money, more cash, more killing. You can't constantly pump into the heads of your children murder, death, and violence, and then think that you can offset that mentality by just saying, be good, don't be violent. But people don't want to challenge the music makers because I already told you that you'd rather be comfortable. And not only would you rather be comfortable, you'd rather be popular. And some of you believe that you're super Christian, so you don't want to be judgmental. But in 1999, we got to be a little judgmental because we got to be able to separate the good in ourselves from the bad in ourselves. We have to be able to separate the good in others from the bad in others. We have to be able to challenge the Pharisees and the wicked. And if we cannot do that, then we cannot claim to be God's people. Many people claim God, but God is power. And if you are powerless, then you need not claim God. God doesn't rejoice in seeing you weak. God doesn't rejoice in seeing you crushed. God doesn't rejoice in seeing you spiritless. God rejoices when he sees the power of his spirit in you come forward to touch the power of the spirit in someone else to move us forward as a collective. Don't blame God for your shortcomings. And don't ask him to cover up for you. Because God is power. To the young people in the audience, the majority of which know that something is wrong with the community and the society, but have no idea how to fix the things that they identify wrong. Yet and still, they don't like the people who are involved in fixing the things that they know is wrong. But you have to make a decision. It's not good enough to say that you don't like it and to do nothing at all. It's not good enough to say that you don't like the leadership and to not be a leader at all. You have to make a decision and become active. Because the bottom line is, you may be 15 in the audience today. You may be 16 in the audience today. And in a blink of an eye, you'll be a pouting mother in the audience 10 or 15 years from now, with your children dying from the same thing, in a state of confusion about what's going on, because you weren't paying attention when it was time to pay attention about the predicament that you find yourselves in. What happened to the black leadership? The black leadership in our community is hunted and pressured. And therefore, it makes it very difficult for any individual person to stand up on their two feet and take the responsibility of offering leadership and commitment and role models to black people. Because you know when you stand on your feet and you step up front, that automatically you're putting yourself in a sacrificial position for the forces that be to feel that they can just rob you of your life and rob you of your freedom and rob you of your justice. But black people have to make a decision. Who's going to make the sacrifice? Who's prepared to make the sacrifice? Have you put in the time to study so that you can offer the right leadership if you're willing to make the sacrifice? Have you been on the front line? Will you get on the front line? Will it make a difference when you get on the front line? But black people are confusing to me. Because when someone stands up who is strong and has a radical voice, black people have a tendency to scatter. And all of a sudden, you were standing there fighting for the people, and you look around, and there ain't no people. I saw black people of every class and persuasion fight harder to save the presidency of Bill Clinton than they fought for any black leader who stood up for black people. So my only conclusion can be that the new black leader is Bill Clinton. Because the way you fight for him, I didn't see duplicated in your fight for Farrakhan or Sharpton or Soldier or Maxine or Lonnie Guinea. I didn't see that fight duplicated for those people who stood up for you. And so we enter an era, once again, where nobody wants to criticize. And nobody wants to be judgmental. But if something is wrong, we gotta hold somebody accountable. Even if they look pleasing to your eye, you gotta hold them accountable. It can't be that when George Bush was president, we held him accountable because he's unattractive, but when Bill Clinton is the president, we don't hold him accountable because we like how he looks in his suit. What's it gonna be? Because leadership sends out messages. And if Bill Clinton is going to be your leader, then you need to tell your leader that he has to declare a state of emergency for people whose children and communities are ripped and torn and decimated by violence and economic poverty. I know he gave some people some jobs. And I know we're always grateful when we have a job. However, when you have a serious problem, you need a serious and radical answer to correct the problem. You don't need to put band-aids on a cancer tumor because you're still going to die. Leadership comes from the top. The same way people stop everything and go to the Middle East and say this is a war-torn society and go and meet with all of the individuals involved in the conflict and take them out to private places and sit down and talk with them for hours and days and so on and so forth. It's the same kind of attention that needs to be given to the African condition in the United States of America today. There were people who said these things long time ago, before I was born and before some of you were born. But when they explained to you that if you allow this system to be capitalistic, that it would turn into the worship of money, we didn't want to hear that, because we were hoping that with our accumulation of little small material things, we would be able to get that car or be able to get that house or be able to share in that American dream or be able to rock that diamond or be able to drape that fur. That's what we were hoping. So when the real people were standing up saying, we need to look at this system of capitalism and what it does and how it impacts African people in the United States of America, the majority of black people turned a deaf ear. Because they didn't want to be involved. They didn't want to be judgmental. They couldn't stand the criticism. But now today, your life is worth nothing compared to money. That is why your arms could be falling off. And if you went to the hospital, if you are not conscious enough to recite your health insurance number, you will be homeless. Because the money to be made off of your life or death is more important than you in a capitalistic system. You send your children to school, but the schools will not teach your children to be powerful. It may teach them to be cooperative, but it will not teach them to be powerful. Because in order for them to be powerful would mean that they were also intelligent, and if they were taught to be powerful and intelligent, the next logical step would be for them to challenge what they see, challenge how they live, and challenge what they feel.
Don't look at me. Your hair's a bit frizzy today.
Aww.
You should pick that up. Oh, you're such a dork.
Loser.
Here, let me help you with that. Oops.
Every day, kids witness bullying.
Oh, look. Your crush is looking at you.
Poor you.
They want to help, but don't know how.
See, no one here is going to help you, because no one
Teach
likes
your kids
you.
How to be more than a bystander. Visit stopbullying.gov.
From the moment I saw you, I went out of my mind. Though I never believed in love at first sight.
But you got a magic, boy, that I just can't explain. Well, you got a way that you're making me feel like I can
do anything for you, baby.
Hey,
I'll be there for you, baby. Lay all my cards out tonight. Just call on me, baby. I'll be there in a hurry. Jump on now, baby. Baby, let's go.
Whatever you want from me, giving you everything. I'm your baby tonight. Giving me ecstasy, cause you are my ecstasy. I'm your baby tonight. Looks like a fatalism on the table, and baby, you hold the cards. You got the magic, and I gotta have it. I don't want the pieces, I want every single part. I'll be your angel, I'm ready, your neighbor, whatever you want is fine. Whenever you're ready, just call on your lady, I'll be your baby tonight.
Hope you like it!
believe don't want to be challenged. They teach your children to be cooperative. And for some children, it works. And for others, they rebel. They don't know why they rebel, but they're rebelling because something ain't right. Nobody will tell them what's not right, but they know that something is not right. When people stood up, not even 20 years ago, to talk about racism, and the system said that the black leaders who are talking about racism to black people are the racists. Many black people in the population turned a deaf ear to the black leaders. I don't want to hear from that cat Farrakhan, he's a racist. I don't want to hear from Malcolm X, he's a racist. I don't want to hear from Al Sharpton, he's a racist. I don't want to hear from Daughtry, he's a racist. Everybody who talks about the condition of African people and the history of our existence in this country was labeled a racist. And because the people who we were talking to, the black people, our people, weren't doing the studying, they didn't understand that there's no such thing as a black racist. And then our own people began to point their fingers at us and say, you know what? You're the racist, Sister Soldier. Al Sharpton, you're the racist. You're the racist. Jesse Jackson, you're the racist. Farrakhan, you're the racist. And then we separate ourselves from one another. But when we separate ourselves from one another and when we become tribalistic, it doesn't help us. It doesn't help our children. It doesn't help our community. It doesn't stop the killing because the attack was never coming from there. The attack was coming from the ignorance within our communities and the system that manipulates our communities and paralyzes it into a state of ignorance. Why is there so much violence in our community? Because we got young black and Latino men who want money and power and should want money and power. Have no idea how to get it and by and large have no elders who can effectively teach them how to get it. So they branch out on their own as young men trying to get a little piece of the action, a little piece of the dream, and then next thing you know, they're dead because they didn't understand how deadly the game that they were playing is. But the American government understands that young black and Latino men would grow up to want a piece of the action. They understand because they were the ones who stole the action. But if you don't want to hear that, and you feel uncomfortable with somebody talking about the American government, and you think it's getting a little hot in here, and if it's just getting and feeling a little bit too radical, then what you need to do is just accept the way that it is. We'll come together every year, and we'll light a thousand candles. We'll just sing and cry and weep and march our way through the national anthem that half of us don't even know the words to. We'll just cry and fall out and die and scream and feel the pain. We just lose for fear of moving forward. I don't mean to make a mockery of anyone or of anyone's life, but I become frustrated with the slow pace at which our people are moving. I become frustrated with the fact that you don't feel powerful enough to contact your neighbors and challenge the situations that you are confronted with. How can a building with 700 people living inside not have garbage service? Can these 700 people not unite around one thing besides the incinerator? What can we do? What does the God in us give us the power to do? Does it give us the power to do anything besides assemble and weep? Does it? Because if it doesn't, then it's useless. So what are we missing? I hear people thank Father God all the time. But I hear people forget to raise Mother God to where it ought to be. You must understand that there is a masculine force, but there is a feminine force. There is no power greater than a feminine force, because we bring all life into existence. We carry it in our bodies, and we nurture that life. And we push it out into existence. So if you as mothers cannot step outside of this crazy and chaotic masculine-made world and say to yourselves that you as mothers must regain control over your children and your husbands and your brothers and your sons, then we must admit that we are simply going to be doing the same thing every single year. You see, because the mothers know. The mothers know, and the women have been taught to stand in the back. And the women have been taught to shut their mouths. And the women have allowed their sons to become their husbands. The women have allowed their sons to be the father of the household. But your son has not learned how to be a man. How can he be the man of your household? You have to tap into that feminine power, because in that feminine power is the kind of love that is necessary to regenerate the movement. Because nobody can understand the pain of loss more than a mother. And I'm willing to bet you that it was the visual image of Amadou Diallo's mother that mobilized the nation to feel indignation with the death of the son. When you looked at that African woman draped in that scarf, you knew she wasn't no hoe. You knew she wasn't no crackhead. You knew she wasn't no absent mother. You knew that she wasn't no tramp. And you identified with the indignation and the pain and the loss that she felt and the way that she looked, and you felt through your television her spirit, the power of her spirit. But if we don't want to acknowledge as women that that power is within us, if we don't want to break the tradition of listening to and following bad advice, if we don't want to create standards that are non-negotiable for our men, if we don't want to teach our sons how to use both their masculine and feminine intuition. If we don't want to do this, then we might as well just deliver our children to the hands of evil, because that is where they will go. Only the mothers can save us now. Only the mothers can save us now. Whether your husband likes it or not, whether your boyfriend, your man, your uncle likes it or not, you've got to get up and make a powerful stand and go out and organize in your community and read and study so that you know what you're talking about, and recollect your children and other people's children so that we can secure them. We cannot be obsessed with the masculine drive for money, sex, and power. We have got to resituate the feminine energy, the female godliness, the mother of mercy, the mother of compassion, the nurturer of all children into our everyday lives. And in the absence of that, there will be nothing. There will be nothing. And I can tell you, as a young girl, when I first began to publicly stand up and speak out, that when people see that feminine power, boy, they want to run and they want to hide. They are afraid of it. And I'm telling you that in my own coming into myself, some of my worst enemies have been the black leaders who want to help the black people who are afraid of the feminine power and the feminine voice that must be included in the analysis and the plan and the strategy to change the world. And women are also intimidated. Because when you see a powerful woman, it ups the ante. It means that it's not enough to be just cute anymore. It's not enough just to get your hair done anymore. It's not enough just to get your nails done anymore. It ups the ante. And I have men tell me all the time, only find a woman like you. And I tell them, I'm married, I'm happily married, but that if you would do justly by a woman, she would be able to find the power in herself. But men have to make a decision. What will you give honor to? Because black men today are looking hoe addicted to me. They are addicted to the whores. They are disdainful towards the mothers. So when you have a good woman who loves and honors you as a man and works with you and tries so hard to love you as a woman, if you can't love her, then you need to understand that that's your disease. If you in the club chasing after a girl who's in the club in hot pants and a bra, wondering why you can't make her your girl, you need to ask yourself, what am I doing? Because what you're asking for is exactly what you're going to get. What happens when you're 13 or 14 or 15 having sex? 10 years later, you'll be negotiating with the woman who gave birth to your child just for the right to see it. You'll have to call her up and beg her to see your child. You will have no control whatsoever on what your child thinks or believes or knows or feels or does, because you were having sex at an age that was so young that you selected the wrong mate, and the mate that you selected is completely crazy. And you are in pain because of your selection, and you're saying, if I only knew when I was 13 or 14 or 15, what I knew now, I'd do everything different. Well, we're telling you today so that you don't have to say that nobody told you. What is our goal? Our goal is to create and to nurture and to protect families. Our goal is to create and to nurture and protect families. Because with a community of families, we have movement. But with a community of dysfunctions, we have nothing but chaos and confusion. pain. We are attempting to produce women who are strong and knowledgeable, who have 360 degrees of power, who understand that being beautiful is not anything that you can thank yourself for. It's something that God gave to you by creating you in His image. Who understand that as women, you must be intelligent. You must be studying. It doesn't matter what your teacher assigns. It is your obligation to go to the public library to explore, to go to black bookstores to explore, to read, to raise questions, and to change the level of conversation. If you meet a guy that you're interested in and all he's talking about is foolishness, you need to use your feminine power to change that conversation. Not drop down to his level and just play in the mud where he's at. We are trying to produce strong women who are clear, who are knowledgeable, who are attractive, and who are godly, who are spiritual. But in order to be spiritual, you have to be able to hear the criticism. And that in order to be a man, you must recognize that there is a force greater than yourself. If you don't acknowledge God, or Allah, or Jah, or Yahweh, or any name that you want to give to that masculine feminine force, if you do not acknowledge it, then what will happen is you will exist in a state of lawlessness, because that means that no one can control you, because there are no rules and there's nothing that you look up to higher than yourself. And right now we wonder why our sons are taken from us, and we question God angrily and say, how could you take our sons from us? Because your sons do not acknowledge God. Your sons pay homage to the devil. Your sons are involved in the devil's work. And your sons have to be humbled in a shocking and horrible way. That maybe they will be reborn spiritually to understand that there is something greater than them to which they must serve humbly. We are trying to produce children who can see the power of God through the example of their mothers and their fathers, who are at least strong enough to get married and stay married and keep the love together, so that the child can understand that there is such thing as structure. I know it hurts because it's a criticism. I know it's radical because it's not what's presently going on. I know it stings because it's a judgment. But I have to say it because it's my job. We are trying to produce children who can see the power of God in the example of their mothers and their fathers, who built safe families for them. We are trying to produce children who understand that if the world is not what it should be, that there is a means to challenge the world effectively and win. We are trying to produce children who are wise and intelligent and have command over a body of knowledge. And by God, when we reach this level of godliness, if somebody or something dares to kill our children, we will come bolting out of our houses with the energy and the force of that godliness and that masculine and feminine power combined and say, my God, my son, my daughter, stop everything. They're killing our children. You see, because if somebody was to rob me of that life that I carried for so long, I would make everybody stop everything right now and take notice of my pain and share in my pain and participate in my pain and pay homage to my pain and help me in rebuilding to help somebody else not have that pain. But if there is not enough love, then we fight harder for who drank the Coca-Cola and who moved my cigarette and who turned the channel, then we fight for our children. Thank you.